Hello and welcome back. We are continuing our basics of science here. Last time we did some good stuff. We talked about the difference between observations and inferences, what empirical means, and we got into the scientific method. We will quickly review the scientific method, and then we'll move on to some important terms in science that a lot of people misuse. The idea of theories, hypotheses, laws. We'll even talk about proof. And so let's diagram out the scientific method. As we said last time, there are certainly a lot of ways of looking at this, but let's look at it from a different point of view. You're going to start off, you're going to observe something, collect data. Let's say you're in the laboratory and you pour through two things together and you get a color change. Well, you're collecting that data in the laboratory. You should be writing that down in your laboratory notebook. But if you're doing that on the street, you'll still be collecting data, of course, and storing it in your brain. At that point, most people are going to make some kind of hypotheses. We're going to try to explain what's going on, why that color change took place. And that's going to require inference. Perhaps you're going to use deduction, induction, abduction. Let's say that we think that color change came from a pH change and that there's an indicator involved. Well, that's a hypothesis to explain what's going on. So that would be abduction. That would lead to a certain experiment. Different types of inference would lead to different types of experiment. You're going to study your results. If your results don't match up with your ideas, then you get into that cyclical nature of science. You'll review your hypothesis, revise it, and get back in the game. Once you're satisfied, once your data is matching what you think is going on, then you're ready to state your conclusions in a way that other people can evaluate. Maybe in a laboratory write-up, maybe in a peer-reviewed journal. But a good scientist puts their work out there to move the body of science forward. Now, a lot of people confuse the terms theories and laws. I'm somewhat embarrassed to say when I started teaching, I certainly had my mistakes in these terminology too. So it's not an uncommon thing to see this even in science. But we want to make sure that we clear this up as much as we can. Theories attempt to explain. And so when someone says, well, that's only a theory, you should probably counter them quickly with saying, well, what do you want this to do? Because I'm trying to explain what's going on, and that's what theories do. There's nothing else that we really have that explains. And they're saying, well, what about a law? And we're going to point out that a law is something very, very different. Theories use models, and those represent complex systems. They aren't literal interpretations of that. So when you have a model car, you don't expect it to be literally the same as a working car. Just as if you see a model of an atom, you don't literally expect protons to have positive signs on them and electrons to have negative signs on them. Theories produce testable predictions. That's the beauty of science. Science is being able to predict future behavior. And so whenever somebody thinks they know something, I say, well, predict what's going to happen next. Show me you know something. Theories gain credibility. Not all theories are the same. And as a theory continues to produce predictable results, they gain credibility. So it's sort of king of the mountain. And if your theory can stay on top and take on all comers, well, that shows that your theory is a solid theory that tries to explain. Even the best theory can be wrong. We certainly have models of the atom that have changed over time. And once we have new evidence, our theory of what atoms are have changed. Theory of relativity. You're trying to explain the observations Einstein saw out in nature. And the theory of evolution is attempting to explain the evidence that we see revolving the change in systems over time. And so you can certainly have another explanation of why things change over time. And if it can be evaluated in a scientific way, then it belongs in that scientific arena. But if it can't be evaluated scientifically, then it certainly doesn't become a scientific theory. A scientific law, on the other hand, does something completely different. A scientific law is an objective empirical statement that summarizes the behavior of the natural world, and it's not open to interpretation. Since they're not trying to explain, theories don't mature into laws. A lot of people think that if a theory eats its vegetables and works out and is a good little kid, someday it's going to grow up and get to be a law, but that simply is not the case. For example, Newton's three laws of motion. You know, if I start you off and say for every action, and you say there's an equal and opposite reaction, we can all agree on that. We can all see that observation in nature. There's no argument about that. You're going to see the same thing I see. But when you start to explain why that's happening, well, then that's getting into theories, and that's something very different. We have gas laws. we can very clearly measure that when you increase the pressure on a system, the volume of a gas is going to go down, all other things being equal. But if you want to explain why that's happening, then you get into theories. The current theories of the kinetic molecular theory. And you might have a different explanation for why that observation is happening, but then you're getting into theories and not laws. So they're very separate. Keep them separate. Now, even though theories don't grow up to be laws, hypotheses can grow up to be theories. Some people use these terms interchangeably, but they're not. When you first start something, you should really say, I have a hypothesis, because a hypothesis still needs to be tested. And once it's tested and held up, then it becomes a theory. And so that's all the difference between those two things are. It's a theory is a hypothesis that's been able to withstand experimentation. Just to wrap up a couple final points, it's important to realize that science is not just a pile of facts. There's a quote, science is no more a pile of facts than a house is a pile of bricks. Science is a deeply imaginative process of trying to explain what's going on. You see something, you want to come up with a story to explain that, and that's fun. And the people with the best imaginations are usually the ones making the biggest progress in science because they're seeing things that other people don't see. And so all these things require creativity. It's important to understand also that science is a human endeavor with all the inherent strengths and flaws of human endeavor. It's done by humans, and hence it's limited by the fact that we are humans. And there are certain times where this has gone both ways. Galileo, his empirical views of the universe were in direct conflict with the current worldview, and that got him imprisoned. Darwin hesitated to publish The Origin of Species because he knew it was a radical idea that flew in the face of a lot of the way that people saw the Earth. The government can certainly affect science about what gets funded and what doesn't get funded. You know, so currently, there are certain types of stem cells that you can research and certain ones you can't. And government certainly has a prerogative to decide how public funds are spent. And that's an interesting debate about, you know, what science is deemed worthy to study and what science isn't deemed worthy to study. You know, the idea of global warming and climate change. You know, who's funding the science and what do they expect out of that? So, you know, buyer beware. A lot of people think of scientists as being these untouchable people in lab coats and a white tower, but they're people making the same mistakes other people do. Not everything can be studied with science. And that's important to understand. If you can't empirically observe it, then your theory cannot be evaluated scientifically, which is frustrating to some people. But if you're trying to explain something with a hypothesis that there is no way to empirically test, then it can't go toe-to-toe with a scientific theory. You can certainly have your explanations, but those are non-scientific explanations of what's going on. So questions of faith, morality, and ethics, these things are important. But can't be evaluated empirically. And so they don't belong in a scientific conversation. Now, that doesn't mean that one's more important than the other. Science and religion certainly both provide vital and distinct roles in society. But science is based on evidence and religion is based on faith. And just because you're a scientist certainly doesn't mean you're religious. And there are many, many, many scientists who are deeply religious based on what they've learned about the universe and how amazing things are. That leads them to have credence of a certain religion. Last but not least, it's important to understand where the word proof belongs in science, and that's really nowhere. Science is built on finding evidence, and you can support your ideas and your hypotheses. You can disprove your idea if you have evidence contrary, but there's no real way to scientifically prove something. Because again, if you're trying to explain things, then you're inferring or you're abducting, and that's going beyond what you have in front of you. And hence, these things cannot be guaranteed to be true. Now, in a court of law, that's totally fine. Remember, in a court of law, you're looking for a preponderance of evidence, enough that you believe it to be true beyond a reasonable doubt. And so, from a legal or historical point of view, proof means something very different. But a scientist never really proves anything. And so remember that. So never say I've proven stuff in science. Say that I've got evidence that supports my hypotheses. And you should not get into any trouble there. So that covers the basics of science. We're we're kind of done with this philosophy, and we'll start getting into some of the more meat and potatoes of measurement and significant figures and scientific notation and all that good stuff to get you squared away on the basics of science. Thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time.